The world is running out of drinking water. Where is it going? How are we using it? And what are engineers doing to combat this? That is what we'll be discussing in this video. A key topic we're going to cover is how to turn seawater into fresh water efficiently. And we can do that using the iSave by Danfoss, who have kindly sponsored this video. I highly recommend you head over to the Danfoss iSave webpage, where you can find a ton of helpful resources about the Danfoss iSave, as well as reverse osmosis. These include case stories, data sheets, and a specialized calculation and selection tool. You can find all of it by following the link in the video description below. We all need to consume around 2 liters of water per day just to survive. Every living cell in our body needs water to keep functioning. Without water, our bodies will simply shut down and we will perish within somewhere between 3 and 7 days typically. But that's not the only water we use. There's all the other daily routines which consume water, such as showering, flushing toilets, washing our hands, food preparation, cleaning dishes, watering our plants, etc. Then there's all the water used for agriculture and manufacturing. We are using so much water that major cities have actually started to run out. In February 2018, the city of Cape Town in South Africa began drastic water restrictions, limiting citizens to just 50 litres per day per person. This was an attempt to avoid what they called Day Zero, the day when the city would run out of water. Overconsumption and drought led to the depletion of water reserves, and Cape Town was set to become the first major modern city in the world to run out of water. Engineers predicted that by April 21st, the water levels in the dams would be so low that they would have to turn the pumps off and water would be handed out at communal collection points throughout the city. Luckily, the city took drastic action and managed to avoid this. This action alone isn't enough though, and Day Zero is predicted to return in 2019. When you look at our planet, around 70% of its surface is covered by water. The problem is that around 67% of this is seawater. Only 3% of this is fresh, and even then, only 0.4% is actually accessible. The other 2.6% is locked in places like ice caps, glaciers, or is in the atmosphere. So we're only left with that 0.4%, which is both accessible, usable, and drinkable. That has to be shared with the estimated 7.7 billion humans on Earth. And this population is growing by approximately 80 million additional people per year. So what are we doing to combat this? This is where the engineers come in. There are many technologies out there. One of the most popular and most obvious is to use seawater. Of course, you can't drink seawater, so we need a way to purify it. A technique we use to do this is called reverse osmosis. The process works like this. You take seawater and remove as much dissolved salts, organics, and pyrogens as possible. The problem is that seawater doesn't naturally want to give this stuff up, so we have to persuade it. First, we need a semi-permeable membrane. Membrane refers to the boundary, and semi-permeable means to permit some. What that means is you pass seawater through a special boundary, kind of like a filter, and that will allow certain substances to pass through it, whereas other substances like dissolved salts will be held back. So you put seawater in and you get fresh water out. It still needs a little more work done to it, but it's usable. This is a slow process though, so to clean a lot of seawater, we need some big sets of semi-permeable membranes, and then we need some very high pressure pumps to force the water through the membrane. Not all the seawater will be turned into fresh water. Some of it is used to flush away all the dissolved salts, etc. As you can imagine, this is an energy intensive process. The pumps are large and consume a lot of energy to create the high pressures required to squeeze the water through the membrane and remove the unwanted substances. To reduce the energy consumption, we need a way to recover some of the energy that's wasted and reuse this. So engineers looked at the high pressure concentrate wastewater coming out of the membrane and decided to find a way to reuse it. This is the water that didn't make it into becoming fresh water and is used instead to flush the dissolved salts, etc. away. What engineers come up with is this, the iSave energy recovery device with an isobaric pressure exchanger and a high pressure positive displacement pump, all driven by a single induction motor. We connect this into the system by taking the high pressure concentrate wastewater and passing this into the pressure exchanger. We then take another line of low pressure seawater and also run this into the pressure exchanger. The two streams briefly come into contact with each other. We'll see how a little later in this video. But the brief contact time is enough for the high pressure wastewater to ram the low pressure seawater, and in doing so, it transfers its pressure. So we have recovered this. The concentrate wastewater leaves the pressure exchanger as a low pressure concentrate, and the seawater leaves as a high pressure seawater. The positive displacement pump at the end of the unit is then used to force the water into the membrane along with the other seawater from the high pressure pump. The process continues as before, and we get fresh water out of the system, but we can reduce our energy consumption by up to 60%. So what's happening inside the iSave and how does it work? We have three main components to the iSave: the induction motor, which drives the unit, the pressure exchanger, which recovers the pressure, and then the pump, which pushes the recovered pressurized water to the membrane. Inside the pressure exchanger, we have a number of empty chambers. These will be filled with the water, and this is where the pressure is transferred. There are some plates at each end to control the flow of water. The low pressure seawater enters the unit and begins to fill up some of the chambers. The induction motor then rotates the entire pressure exchanger, so the chamber of low pressure seawater then rotates around to the high pressure side. The high pressure concentrate wastewater then enters the unit and rams into the low pressure seawater inside the chamber. As the two waters collide, the pressure is transferred from the high pressure side and into the low pressure side. This forces the seawater out of the chamber and into the pump. As the seawater leaves the chamber then fills with the concentrate wastewater. The seawater is now pressurized as it took some of the pressure from the concentrate during the collision. The now high pressure seawater then enters the pump and is forced into the membrane for the reverse osmosis to take place. The concentrate water has lost some of its pressure, so is now a low pressure concentrate wastewater. This is still inside the chamber, so as that rotates, it comes back around to where the low pressure seawater is entering. The seawater pushes the concentrate out of the chamber and then fills with seawater, where the whole process will then repeat. By doing this, we have recovered the pressure from the wastewater, so the workload by the main high pressure pump has been reduced, making the entire operation more efficient and cheaper to produce. The two streams do come into direct contact with each other, so there is some mixing of the fluids. But the whole thing happens very fast, so the amount of mixing is small. The seawater still has to pass through the membrane to be cleaned, so this mixing is not a major issue. You can learn more about the iSave and reverse osmosis by heading over to the Danfoss iSave website using the links in the video description below. Okay, that's it for this video, but if you want to continue your learning, then click on one of the videos on screen now and I'll catch you there for the next lesson. Don't forget to follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, as well as theengineeringmindset.com.